Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us. It is my prayer that the content that you're about to enjoy adds value to your life. If you like it, please let us know by hitting that like button. Also, we'd love to connect with you, so please leave a comment below letting us know your thoughts. If you know someone who will enjoy this content, make sure to share it with them. For more content like this, subscribe to our channel and hit the notifications bell so that you never miss when we post something new. Don't forget to check out the video description for links to more information and other resources. May God bless you.
Good morning, church family. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Yes. Wow, I'm seeing some people I haven't seen in a while. This is good. This is really good. It's good to be back. The message today is called A Street Called Dissatisfaction. And this street exists. It's found in Miami, in Memphis, in Melbourne, in Medford, in Myrtle Beach, Milwaukee, Middleton, Meridian, Mama's house, maybe in your life and mine. When I'm driving in my car and a man comes on the radio, he's telling me more and more about some useless information. Supposed to fire my imagination. I can't get no. Oh, no, no, no. Hey, hey, hey. That's what I say. I can't get no. Hundreds of millions of people can relate to this Rolling Stones song as they live on a street called dissatisfaction. And I'm not talking about the type of dissatisfaction that leads to change, because that's a good type of dissatisfaction. I'm talking about the type of dissatisfaction to where you cannot seem to find in your life a way to be content, joyful, and at peace. And when we see this kind of dissatisfaction in our church family, that means that's an indicator that something's wrong. Because God didn't say in the Bible that that was to be your experience, that you would be dissatisfied. Jesus said in John 15, 11, these things I have spoken unto you, that my joy may remain in you. John 10, 10, I've come that they may have life, and that life might have it more abundantly. One more for those taking notes, John 14, 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I leave. So God is offering us life and joy and peace, which are the opposite of dissatisfaction. I could see why Mick Jagger's singing, I can't get no satisfaction. But I can't get why in my life as a Christian I would be singing, I can't get no satisfaction. Something's off. And if that car that you drive is parked on a street called dissatisfaction, you've come to the right place today, because that's exactly what we're going to talk about and figure this out. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you want to teach us and speak to us through your word, through your presence. So please do that. Thank you that we could be together, and for the privilege to open your word. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Yeah, thank you for scripture reading. That was fantastic, wasn't it? The McCain boys are growing up. McChain, I should say. And the music was what a blessing, wasn't it? What a blessing. So I want to thank the Adoration Praise Team for being up here and blessing us with that. We are going to jump into Mark chapter 8. So if you want to turn there in a Bible, we're going to spend all our time just in this space. And talk about the kind of kingdom that Jesus is wanting to usher in back then, the kind of kingdom he's wanting to usher in right now. And the kind of kingdom God is bringing is really, really good. It's not like the kind of kingdom the lady that was sleeping in the room next to me in Phoenix this last week was ushering in. All I could hear from her is, you know, blank this and blank that and blank, blank, blank. And you, I told you never to call me, and why are you calling me, and blah, 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 blah. And it was like, I just felt like calling her up and saying, what's your problem? Then she got off the phone and started arguing with her husband. And then I was like, I see what your problem is. The world's your problem. So we're going to look at Mark chapter 8. The leaders, to say that they were dissatisfied with Jesus is total understatement. They absolutely hated his guts. And the only solution they seemed to have to silence Jesus was to kill him. And Jesus starts to refer to this. So Mark 8, verse 31, and he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, rise again. Peter hears this declaration. It's jolting, as it would be for any of us. If I told you I'm going to die very soon by whatever entity, you would be like, it's specifically, this is jolting to them because of their aspirations of what he was going to do. And so Peter decides that it's time to teach Jesus. Now, none of us here have ever done that, where we're going to teach God something. We know what's best. You know, it doesn't matter, you know, what he you know, he's saying in his word. It doesn't matter about his principles. I remember this lady one time telling me, she was married, but she had a boyfriend, and she's like, you know, I love this man, and so does God, he, you know, he's happy with him too. And it was like, you couldn't teach her anything, and the only one that wanted to teach was her. And so Peter came to this place where he wanted to teach. He wanted to teach Jesus something. This was his opportunity to rebuke Jesus. How do we think that'll go? So Mark chapter 8, verse 32, and he was stating the matter plainly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. So for whatever reason, Peter decides he's going to bring him maybe outside of the circle. Maybe he's looking over his shoulder at the disciples to make sure they can't hear what he's about to say. And now he's going to share with them what's on his heart. And he rebukes him. Just says he rebukes him. Probably something like, you know, that's never going to happen. There's no way they're going to kill you. We're never going to let that happen to you. And in verse 33, but turning around, Jesus turning around and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on God's interest or the things of God, but man's. And I'm sure Peter was a little shell-shocked by that. He's probably thinking, Jesus just called me Satan. That's a little startling. You wouldn't tell, hey, Satan, do your kids acting up? Hey, Satan, get in your room. It was startling to him. And here Peter's trying to identify the problem, and it's got turned around, and Jesus is saying the way you're thinking is the problem. Reminds me of a true story of this worker who was tired of someone using their salad dressing that was in, it was nice and cozily settled into the fridge at the company kitchen at work. And so one day they decided they were going to make a note, put a note on it to change that person's behavior. And the note said, do not use! I spit in this. since someone keeps using it. Thanks. Exclamation point. So then the guilty party snuck in there and wrote their own little note on it and said, I spit in it too, since you're a jerk. Peter's going to Jesus to try to correct him, and Jesus turns around and says, the correction's not with the way I'm thinking. The correction is needed to take place in the way you're thinking, because what you're doing is you're setting your mind on the things of man instead of the things of God. Now, this is really, really important, because Peter came with the intention to help Jesus, but Peter was the one that needed help. And God wants to encounter us today and get us to a place where the way we're thinking is the way God is thinking, because if we keep thinking the way man thinks, we're only going to make a mess of our lives, and it's only going to get more messy. And you see all this stuff about self-help and what you need to do and this and that, and I'm telling you, if the key principles of what we learned today are not in them, all it is a band-aid. Right? It's like somebody hacked off my arm and someone comes up and gives me a band-aid and says, here, put this on. It's not going to help. I'm going to bleed out. And we're going to continue to bleed out if our minds are not stayed on the things of God. And it's getting more and more difficult because there's more and more distractions, including phones. And it's not that the phones are bad. It's just that it's getting harder. But there's good news today. We have some steps. We have a solution to that. Very simple. And we're going to dig into that. But God wants us to encounter the way He thinks. Get our mind off of the tabloids and the news flashes and the trends of today and go beyond our own personal pursuits and get our minds off of the troubles of the world and the troubles in our life and at work and in this country. Even beyond the natural disasters that are taking place every day almost in this world. And they're getting so frequent that it's for us a blessing to recognize them, because what Jesus is saying is that time is running out. The clock is ticking faster, and you've got to get to a place where Jesus is everything in your life, because it's going to get too scrambled for you to figure it out later. You got to figure it out now. Life is good now. Life is okay now. Regardless of what you're struggling with, it's okay right now. But it's not going to be okay forever. Some tsunami will hit your life. Will you be ready? Will you be able to handle it? Well, as we stand on the borders of eternity, yes, you will. If you adopt what Jesus is teaching in this passage of Scripture, God says in Isaiah 55:8, My thoughts are not your thoughts. They're not your thoughts. My thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways. As high as the heavens are above the earth, is that pretty high? Can we get a rocket ship that high? As high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways above your ways and my thoughts above yours. And so God wants to get us to think through this message today and really embrace it. And Peter and his disciples, as they're hearing Jesus say, I'm going to be killed, to them this is hard to understand, because for them, Jesus has triumphed over evil in so many ways. He's healed the sick. He gave sight to the blind. He raised the dead. He spoke with unquestionable authority. He could not be trapped by the schemes of the leaders. He could command storms to stop. He could walk on water. He could multiply food. He could read people's minds. So when someone with that kind of power says they're going to abuse me and kill me, for the disciples, they're like, how is that even possible? That's not going to happen. And Jesus is going to make it really clear that has to happen. And I want to share this with you. This isn't in the manuscript, but I want to share this with you. There are many things in your life that are very, very hard to understand of why they were allowed to happen. And like Job, you really won't ever understand. But the thing the devil wants to do is get you to question God's integrity instead of Satan's integrity. And he wants you to forget, as secular media does, that we are in a spiritual warfare that's manifest every single day in every single one of our lives, every time we wake up to our alarm clock. And when you're in a spiritual warfare, terrible things happen because we are on a planet that is in rebellion. It's in a tick-tock, minute-by-minute rebellion. And it's not going to get better. It's only going to get worse. Why? Because of people's decisions. And I've done some stupid things in my life where I've shot myself in the foot. Metaphorically speaking, that is. I haven't, like, shot myself in the foot. I did break out my front tooth, though, one time, swinging off a T-bar. That was pretty stupid. Clothesline. And I was like, hey, Christy, watch this. And I jumped and swang down. And ba-dong! I don't know where that came from. Jesus, in verse 34, wants to help correct their thinking. And he summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if anyone, now I'm going to have, I need you to stop when I stop reading this. I don't want you to read on, because I want to share with you something the devil does all the time to us. He says in verse 34, he summoned the crowd and said, if anyone wishes to come after me. Now this is really important. Because what Jesus is saying is if you're going to follow me, you have to do this. There's no exceptions to it. If you want to be a follower of Christ, if you want to live a life that ends with a rapture where we leave this place together for the greatest homecoming this universe has ever experienced, and we get to fly through space to a place in heaven where Christ has prepared mansions for us. If we want to follow Christ, we have to do this. And I want to pause here for a second, because the devil is really, really good. He's really, really good at distorting God's purposes in order for us to be dissatisfied with what they should look like in our lives. And I don't know if I need to state that somewhere, some other way. Maybe I do. It's that we become dissatisfied with the perception of what God is asking us to do. That is the devil's way of working. It worked in heaven to deceive the angels. It worked with Adam and Eve. I'm going to get you to be dissatisfied with the order of things in the Garden of Eden so that you will no longer be happy with God's plan. You're going to be happier with my plan. And this has happened. So when we read this verse, let's ask ourselves the question, does this sound like, does what Jesus, what he is describing here in these verses, does it sound like good news to me? Or asked another way, is this a killjoy in my life, what Jesus is describing? Is this going to breed discontent in my life if I follow what Jesus is teaching? Because it's not a guide to discontentment. But the devil can make us think in hearing this that if I follow this, oh, I'm going to be so discontent. I'm going to be so unhappy doing that. And it's quite the opposite. So let's read this verse and see what it does for you. And he summoned the crowd and the disciples and said to them, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And when you hear that, what do you think in your life? Do you see that as good news? or is it something different? Well, let's ask this question. How has it been working out for us on this planet? As we've chosen not to deny self and not to pick up our cross and not to follow Christ. The South American drug lord doesn't deny himself. The corrupt politician doesn't deny himself, nor the rambler or the gambler or the backbiter. Is the pimp denying themselves? Or the dictator or the rich and shameless, the corrupt lawyer and the greedy business owner, the lazy teenager, the game-addicted kid, the gangster, the porn addict, the drunk, the sugar junkie, the abusive parent, the guy that cut you off on I-84 the other day? Are they denying? How is it working out for us when we do not live a life where we're denying ourselves? What does that look like? Well, watch the news tonight. That's what life looks like when we don't follow the prescription that Jesus is giving us to follow him. And God is offering us something so much better. So much better. We're being associated with Jesus, the kindest, humblest, most patient, wisest, bravest, holiest, greatest, glorious King of Kings and brother to mankind. The better life is found right in these verses, verse 34. If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. When Adam and Eve sinned, their nature was immediately changed. They got recoded. They got recoded with Satan's and with Satan's beautifully written, deceptive, corrosive life view, worldview. And so they no longer had this capacity to love unconditionally and appreciate God the way they appreciated him before, with one simple choice to listen to Satan and disobey God. They no longer wanted to be in God's presence. They started to blame each other. They just changed, and there was only one solution to this. God was going to have to step in through his son Jesus and take on the penalty for that, the sins of our parents, Adam and Eve, and all the way down through to us. He was going to have to take the penalty. But he was also going to provide a way to rewrite the way we think, which is good news. I don't want to think the way 18-year-old Troy Higginson thought, my friends. I don't want to think that way. I don't want to think the way the 22-year-old Troy Higginson thought. I don't even want to think the way the Troy who thought he got a degree in theology and now he's better than everybody else think. We're all messes, right? I mean, if I'm just going to be transparent, I don't want to think like that. I don't even want to think the way I thought last year. I want to get into this place where I have this deep, abiding love for Christ that's manifest in humility and peace and joy, where I can see and know you as the treasure you are, because my mind's not on next week or what I have to do tomorrow or where I should be right now because something's happening in my life. I want to be engaged, and we can't engage in life if we're not connected with Christ. And we can't connect with Christ unless we deny ourselves. If you were never designed to just live a life where you're just going to fill yourself with all your self-desires, do whatever you want with your life, live selfishly, ruin people's lives, that was never what God designed for you. He is calling you to be a peacemaker. He's calling you to be an advocate for loving change in this world. So if anyone would come after Jesus, he must deny himself and pick up his cross. So self-denial and picking up the cross in simple terms is to live self-sacrificially. To live self-sacrificially. And I know that's hard. It's when things, it just goes against our nature. But these are the two ways to get off of dissatisfaction street. The reason why we're so miserable in this world is because we're all living for ourselves. In the universe, nobody lives that way and they're all happy. Planet Earth, we're all doing that and we're finding ourselves in mental crisis day after day after day. It's just very hedonistic world we live in, but Jesus wasn't like that. And God didn't design your life to be wasted away in self-indulgence and sin, but as a mighty influencer for good. We need the influence of good in this world. We need it desperately. Everybody's suffering. Kids are suffering. Families are suffering. I was listening to this guy. He was walking behind me. He was drunk. And this happened a couple weeks ago. And I don't know how in the world he could have talked to his wife like that in public. I mean, he was calling her the B word every other sentence and da-da-da-da-da-da and was just like rat-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. I mean, he was mowing her down with his machine gun mouth. But that's just one marriage. That's marriage after marriage. I remember moving in. I got all kinds of bonus material for you guys today. I only preach once or twice a year, so this is good. But it will be short, I promise you that. Is my neighbors, one day when we lived in Pennsylvania, we were talking with them, and I said, your kids are so well-behaved. It was a really good thing to say to them because I didn't find out till about 8 or 9 months later that their kids weren't so well-behaved. So they're on their best behaviors. I mean, they're probably just fighting like, I hate you, but I can't scream it right now because the neighbors think you're good kids, you know. And one day they just let loose, and you could hear the daughter, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. And after that, it was just like they just let their filter down. You could hear them fighting all the time, you know. I was like, oh, those are great kids over there and great parents. I mean, here's the thing. As much as the world works and moves forward with formality and functionality, it's very, very dysfunctional at so many different levels because there's only one way to really live life in goodness, and that's with Christ at the center. And I'm thankful the Spirit of God is working in people's lives that aren't studying the Bible. They're not Christians. They may be Buddhists or Muslim or whatever religion, but the Spirit of God, they're receptive to that so that they can be changing and living a life that's a life of self-denial and self-sacrifice. And so Jesus plainly speaks that out. So here's the question. How do we get to a place where we can count it an honor to live self-sacrificially for God? Because we have to get to that place. Well, the good news is that everything that you input into your life to become more like Christ changes you. Going to church changes you. Listening to a spiritual song and singing to it changes you. Choosing to open the door for somebody instead of just walking through and letting it slam on their face changes you. The friends that you've chosen to get out of your life for good reason changes you. And the friends you bring into your life for good reason changes you. Every time you pick up the Bible, it changes you. That's why for I don't even know how many years I was telling you, please read your Bibles at least a chapter a day, 5 out of 7 days a week, over and over and over again, because it changes you. What doesn't change you is watching YouTube shorts. What doesn't change you is watching TikTok videos. What doesn't change you is watching CNN every night or Fox News or whichever news agency you think has the truth. That's not going to, and I'm not saying don't be informed, I'm just saying unless you're putting into your life, unless you are putting God's presence, allowing, I should say, you don't put his presence anywhere, but allowing his presence into your life, unless you're doing that, you're not going to live the life that God has for you. And dissatisfaction is always going to be your story. And yeah, you might be sinning more boldly because you've turned God away. but it's not a life of satisfaction. Satisfied? No. Pacified? Yes. There's lots of stuff to pacify us. Believe me. But satisfied? Deeply soul level satisfied? There's nothing but what Christ can offer. That's it. It's all there is. And it's enough. So let me close with this illustration. It's a story by Ernest Gordon. And he was a prisoner of war, World War II. And he was on the Kwai River in Thailand. The British soldiers that he was part of were captive and they were in a labor camp working on this railroad that was going through the jungle. And their life was miserable. I mean, they were tortured, right? They were tortured. And the behavior of their captors was just dehumanized them to a place where they were just brutal to each other as well. And then something happened one afternoon that changed the trajectory of their lives. When they got through checkpoint one, they had so many shovels, they had the correct amount, they did a bunch of labor. As they moved to checkpoint two, one of the shovels was missing. The man in charge, the officer in charge, told them as he pulled out his pistol that he was going to shoot every one of them if they didn't produce the missing shovel. And he meant it. Killing a prisoner was nothing. Nobody would step forward. Finally, one man stepped forward. One man out of all of them stepped forward. Officer put his gun into his holster, and then he beat him to death. The men picked up his broken, precious body and took him to the next checkpoint, where they discovered on their next shovel count that they miscounted. And the men realized that this soldier who stepped forward sacrificed his life so the rest of them could live. And it completely changed the whole camp. Word went all the way through camp, and it radically started to shift the way they were treating each other. And when the Allies came and rescued him, all of them, all these skeleton of men stood between the Allies and their captors and pleaded for them to not kill these soldiers or abuse them, but to stop the violence, stop the killing, and start forgiving. That is what the world needs from us. They need to see self-sacrificing love. They need to see us living self-denial, because selfishness, it always ruins everything. God doesn't want us to live selfishly. He wants us to live self-denyingly, if that's even a word. I don't even know. So will you do that? I want to ask the praise team to come up. Will you choose in your life to live self-denyingly? And I want to share something with you as a challenge. This is a step. I'm going to make a confession as a pastor. Many, many years in pastoring, I was not reading my Bible daily. Many years. Some of you in this room are not reading your Bible daily and haven't been for a long, long time. But there's good news. I created a tool so you could read your Bible daily. And this isn't a self-plug to make money, because I've already given the app to the church to use for perpetuity till Jesus comes. But if you want to join a group and do a reading challenge, and they're very, very effective, because when you report that you've read your chapter for the day, everybody in your group knows it. And if you don't report that you've read your chapter for the day, everybody in the group knows it. So it gives you an accountability so that you can see that, hey, we've committed to this challenge together and we're going to journey together. It's very, very effective of getting you to read your Bible. And so all you need to do is email the church office and say, hey, I want to do the 29-day Bible reading challenge. You're going to read the book of John, and in the first three letters of John, they're very short, a chapter a day. And so if you're watching online, same thing. Email the church. I don't care where you live. I have a group in Cloverdale. We're scattered across the U.S., quite a few here in Cloverdale. We do reading challenges all the time. So if you're like, yeah, I need something to get me over this hump because I'm not picking up my Bible. It's like I could pick it up and blow dust off of it. This is a way to get through that. That's step one, because the application to this is, okay, I want to, yes, living self-denyingly to honor God sounds wonderful. How do I start? It's by reading your Bible. That's where you can start. You've got to start reading your Bible. If you're not reading your Bible, God's not calibrating your mind to navigate this world in a healthy way. You're just not thinking the right way. The Bible was designed to recalibrate our thinking. So that's step one. If you want to do that challenge or find out more about it, just email the church. The second step is, I want to make an altar call today for anybody here who knows that, hey, I have not been living a life where I'm denying myself. I've been very selfish. I want to start over with God today. Now, I want to ask you to come forward during this song and just give it back. If that's your decision to say, I want to reset today, I don't want to live a life where I'm living for self anymore. I want to invite you to come forward. It's going to take courage, but that's okay. Don't worry about what anybody, we've all could come forward on any given day. But you can come forward and say, Lord, I have made a mess. I'm just living for self. I'm just self-consumption mode, but I want to start over. I want to invite you to come forward. And the other group that can come forward is if you've never given your life to King Jesus, today is the day. We are running out of time, friends. We are running out of time. And God is pleading with us. He is pleading with us to get serious about our spirituality. You can be immature about all kinds of things in life, but don't be immature about your spirituality. Please don't do that. And so if you want to give your life to Jesus, today is the day you can come forward with this song. But if you also are at a place where I've been living selfishly, I've not denied myself, I'm not living self-sacrificially, I want to change, I want to start over, then please come forward during this song as well. So let's all stand. We're going to sing this together. It's a beautiful song. Word of God speak. I hope He's spoken to your heart today. I hope you're hearing His voice. He loves you so much. Let's get ready. I want to go home. You want to go home? All right, amen. Let's sing this together.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Your you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you for loving us so much. You know our hearts. You know what we're thinking right now. You have pure love for us. And Lord, everyone in this room, we can all confess we've lived so selfishly. We've done so many things wrong. We've had so many wrong things done to us. But you never do us wrong, Lord, never. And we want to change the way we live so that we can honor you. And we can be loving like you. You give us the power. We just have to make the choice. And you see the people that have come forward, Lord, whether it's to give their life to you for the first time or to say, Lord, I want to re-give my life to you and deny self. Oh, Lord, please help us. Forgive us for our sins. And thank you that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords has conquered sin. He's conquered the enemy. May he conquer the selfishness in our hearts, that we can live a life that's beautiful, that we could get off of the street called dissatisfaction and live a life of glory as you designed us to. May your spirit be poured out on each of us here, and especially those that came forward, that our lives and the days and weeks ahead would become beautifully changed by your presence. And we pray these things. All of us say, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
I hope you are blessed by today's message. If you have any questions or would like someone to pray with you or for you, please feel free to contact us. May God bless you and keep you till we meet again.